first thing that was actually asked by Hubertus was to do a talk together with Hélène Cixous, which we might do next year in June. Hélène Cixous actually didn't know the work. She got to know it through an older collector of mine, who was a friend of hers. And this was the time when my show had been in four venues in the States and ended in the Palais des Beaux-Arts in Brussels. And she came, she only comes when the museum is closed, of course. And she came with two assistants and we walked through the show. I walked her through the show, and at the end she said, yeah, of course the Parisians don't get it because they're too stupid, and she wrote a book about it, which actually quite, Relevé de la mort, is actually a quite interesting book. It will be translated within this and a year into English, I hope. We had a lot of problems with the publishing house, La Différence, but well, that's something else. That's a Parisian Jewish story. So that didn't happen, and therefore I found myself here alone. As I said, we touched, I think, on all the topics I wanted to touch upon, except one, which was the movie of Werner Herzog that we didn't came to see. I wanted to see something that I hadn't myself seen either. So how are we going to proceed? I mean, the easiest way out would be for me to talk about my work. That would be the easiest way out. I actually am not going to do that. What I am going to do, though, is I'm going to show you the work without any explanation. We're going to look at it, and it's going to be pasted. It's about, what, 250 images? Let's see what you retain. I mean, we can still come back at it later after I've talked, because there's also a book that apparently didn't get to the students. So I'm going to, I first wanted to talk about another talk I once gave, which was like curating the library, where I was actually thought I was asked if somebody wanted, was as voyeuristic as to want to know what I also taught. And I took three books that were important for me, which was like The Ethics of Spinoza, Aesthetic des Voorschijns of Bloch, and Het Leven op Aarden, which is a Dutch writer, Jan Jacobuslaaf. I'm not going to go that either. So I'm going to talk about the very first text that was written about my work, and which actually came to being because there was no time to. Actually, I speeded up during the fact that I was invited in 1992 by Jan Hoed for the very first documenta I was in, and I had my own pace, and I was very afraid that it would the whole situation, the production, everything would be speeded up, and it would have an impact on the integrity of my work. So I phoned Bert de Baere, who was the assistant of Jan Hoed, and said, ask Jan, it's not my generation, not to put me in a documenta. Maybe it's better to be in a documenta not made by a Belgian. But then Jan, of course, such a charismatic and media figure, actually went on the news and announced that I was there, and I didn't have the powers then yet to sort of withstand that. So I actually made sure that all the shows that were planned came right up front of the documenta, especially the one in the Kunsthalle in Bern, which was at that point still a very, it's also Switzerland, a very interesting and still powerful place to show you, Kunsthalle, to show your work. That made that everything was speeded up, so it was very difficult to create a catalog. So Dr. Ulrich Loke, who was then actually the director of the Kunsthalle, asked me to come to Düsseldorf and to talk. And I talk German. German is actually my best foreign language because my very first sexual experience was a German woman. When I was 16, the Astrid, the only vacation I made with my parents. And it was quite funny because, of course, left home immediately and I lived in Prenzlauer Berg in Berlin until another organization, also German, Interpol, found me back. And then 6 months later, I was able to go back, but she was shooting herself up. She was dead on arrival. So it took a while for me to go back to Berlin. But anyway, so we did this talk in German, and he transcribed it. And I'm going just to read it from this book. It's translated in English here. Just because it's funny, because it's the very first attempt to sort of like, in my, let's say, own words, talk about the work. It only runs to 1992. The work you're going to see is going to run to, well, I'd say the last ones is like from this year or last year. And then I'm going to talk about the text I was asked to write for quite a highbrow it's a little newspaper called The White Raven, and they asked me to write something about the moving image. And they were all academics and that. And when I delivered the text, the main editor said, it's a great text, did you write it yourself? So I'm going to just sit myself over there. We're going to put out the light, and we're just going to look. say something, maybe. I mean, this is actually the portrait of the brother my mother got killed in the war. But it's one of the oldest works. I mean, some of the works are like nearly 40 years old, which is nearly half a century. Just move on. Yeah. Is this too fast, or? Move on, because it's going to take too long. I mean, I also know you're anxious. It's your last day, so. One of the rules of my work is that my work should not remind you of any sound or music, let alone the sound. Now we're 1994. Yep. So, I mean, if anybody has any image later on, we'll see what happens. You can get it back. So the text I'm going to read is called The Disenchantment. It's from 1991. And of course, there's also the influences block is in it because I make a statement in the beginning which is called the small gap between the explanation of a picture and the picture itself provides the only possible perspective on painting. My comments refer only to its ambiguity. Behind some pictures, there are 10 other pictures, which I mean a lot of pictures were overpainted because I didn't have the money to buy a canvas, for example. So like there's some pictures in the beginning, there's like 9, 10, even 10 paintings under it. From different years. I can't project myself completely into the picture. If I did that, I wouldn't be detached enough to paint it. Explanations come later. Thinking and feeling and working out feelings are different elements, each with its rhetoric of its own. A memory-free zone arises between conception and execution. There is a reminiscence to Bloch there, in a sense, between the idea of the nichts, I mean, between the two lines that something is becoming something. That was my interest also in Bloch. Then it starts with the loss of the painting. The model for the painting, Our New Quarters, this one you saw, was a photograph of the courtyard of Theresienstadt beneath which a prisoner had written Our New Quarters. When I saw the picture, a building like barracks, just one tree, and the title beneath it, I had a sense of apathy, something that radiates only the absence of life. Because in the picture, the writing is very bright on the dark background. This actually comes from, it's maybe also nice to talk about the works without you seeing them. So this is comes from a real prisoner, I mean, it was Alfred Cantor, who was actually, well, the first thing, most of these people were sort of brought together, he was Czech, of course, in Theresienstadt. From there, he went to three other camps, which was like Auschwitz, Schwarzheide, and was actually liberated by the Russians, and weirdly enough, they were reassembled again in Theresienstadt. Now, in the time that he was there, they put out postcards, and he like just took a box of those postcards, and in 1970, I think, I should have brought the book, in 1970, he made not a diary, but he made drawings. And he glued this postcard in the beginning of the book. And of course, in the time, these postcards were used to send to the family, which he did, of course, when he was in Theresienstadt. And he then, of course, an American, because he was then an American, wrote Our New Quarters. I found that really astonishing and moving in the sense that there was no, as if nothing had changed, basically. If you see a lot of these drawings from inmates, they are quite similar to each other. They have a similar feel, which is, of course, quite depressing. But and it was also one of the first times I went through the taboo. I mean, there's another painting, The Gas Chamber, which you also saw was the most problematic painting I made, probably. But we'll talk about that, too. But anyway, so the reason to use a sort of military color, a non-color, which is this green, and I painted it very fast, that which you can see. I mean, I come from a... I was actually a very gestural, non-formal painter with a lot of color. And in order to create a signifier, I decided not to do that. And also, I decided not to make art from art. I mean, that's also something I think you can admire artists and you can get something out of it, but you can't really do something with it. I mean, there are, of course, influences. Therefore, I took much more the idea of starting from a certain reality and a very close history because of several reasons. One reason is an autobiographical reason, that is because of the family. I mean, I come from, my background is actually, my father was Belgian from the Flemish side, my mother was Dutch. And I'm not going to give you a history lesson, but the Flemish side collaborated twice with the Germans. It was an unhappy marriage, and actually the one side, the Flemish side, was collaborating and the Dutch side was in the resistance. And this came out on a family gathering where a photo album falls on the ground and there is the photograph of the guy I'm named after, which was the brother of my father presenting the Hitler salute. He died as a mascot of a SS troop when he was 17 in Stettin. The other guy, two brothers died, the one I painted also died, but for the other reasons. So you can imagine the element. Whenever there was a problem, and there were a lot of problems and a lot of fights, it was always during dinner time. It took me till I was 32 to enjoy food. I just ate and left. I mean, there's the beautiful quote by Canetti also that he, in Massa und Macht, where he writes about the table where people are eating and they're crying, because this is the last aggression they have left, basically. And so that's the one reason. The other reason is that in a greater perspective, I mean, the Second World War was the specific war where Europe lost its colonies, powers, and of course, due to the specificity of the sort of focused annihilation of one group of people, it created a psychological breakdown. I thought these were quite interesting building blocks to start from. I mean, not a lot of work is about it, but it was a starting point. So there is another thing that comes into game, which is like because I just skipped this now just to make it a little bit more easier, which is place. You know, in the camps there were prisoners who made drawings, and afraid of discovery, they divided the drawings and sort of like into little strips that they distributed. That was the painting you saw of the how do you call it, the Tannenbaum? I mean, how do you say it? Like pine tree, right? With the lines. That's what that symbolizes. That's what you see when you go to Schwarzheide. There's a little blockhouse. Of course, most of these drawings are totally incomplete, of course. So what I did is I bought a primed canvas, put it in the sunlight so it yellowed naturally, and the substance they used was a substance which was made of charcoal and another thing which gives this sort of very weird azure-like color. And then painted that on and paint the lines on it, and that sort of symbolizes what I just said. It's actually a painting about the naturalization of death, in a sense. And then there's the element of time. There's another painting which you saw, which is the four images with the end where they have the guy with the sunglasses, which is actually one part of the painting that is not painted. It is actually cut out of a propaganda magazine called Signal. And it's the face of Richard Heydrich. Richard Heydrich was the second in command after Himmler, I think. It was also the most beautiful Nazi, I suppose. And he, at the Wannsee conference, decided in about, I don't know, 3 or 4 hours, how to make the logistics to kill off 8 million people. This particular group of work started out as an accident. I didn't have canvas, so I cut up a piece of a cardboard box and started to paint on it. I wanted to paint something metaphysical, like time of day, which is the first image you see. And it's also an inscription that says nothing to see, which means nothing in sight. And the second one could be a blow up. There's also an element you should know that I stopped painting from, let's say, 80 till 85 because it was too suffocating, it was too existential, and I started to work with film till 85 and then returned back to painting, which was important because it gave me the correct distance to reassert the idea of painting. Actually, the lens sort of helped, and there is a great similarity, and we'll talk about that later in another text, a great similarity between the idea of filming and painting. I would be a very bad photographer because I would be too late. There's no doubt about that. But filming and painting are both about the approach of the image, which is fascinating. That's why they're very difficult to be combined. I mean, I think they have a similar intensity, although their practice is totally different in terms of physicality. In the end, I was working with 35 millimeters, so I had a crew, so that's a totally different type of propelling an image. But the intentionality of it, I mean, and the intensity, I think, has grave similarities. So I just say that because this was the ones you saw, like after the portrait, and the ones of the first two ones, the ones that come after that, come exactly after the film adventure, and they are informed by that experience, which means that it's there that the idea of cropping the image, editing the image, which are all filmic things, which you don't see in real life, like a close-up does not really exist. come into being, and also the element that the detail can become the whole, which is an interesting part also. And that's why I actually gave the title "Die Zeit" to that particular situation, because the first two were accidents. It was like the blow up of a shop, and then I didn't know what to do. So I started to look in my archive, and I found spinach tablets that were made for the East with the German soldiers at the Eastern Front, which were reused at the NASA project. And then stumbled upon the one image, which was a commemorative image in Signal, which is a propaganda magazine, which was distributed outside of Germany, not in Germany, basically, and in different languages, like Spanish, Dutch, whatever, all the conquered ones. When I did the show in the National Gallery in Berlin, I actually used that format as a catalog for my show, which meant the catalog was reasonably aggressive. It was sold out in 2 weeks. It was never reprinted. I think Walter Koenig bought more than three quarters of it. You can still buy it, but it's actually too expensive for what it is. But the one funny thing is that the people that actually printed that catalog printed the real thing during the war. I mean, there's no country so elliptical as Germany, basically. So in that sense, it's quite ironic. So from there, that's why the element of time came in, because if you look the cutout face of Heydrich, which I masked, and the colors of the sort of urban setting, sort of the image collapses in a sense. And it's like you sort of put this, you turn on your watch. It gave me that very specific feeling. It's just a feeling. A lot of imagery can be explained, but not really totally in a sense. There was another image, that's the walk, which is the transparency, it's called, and it was just a combination. Maybe if you remember that, it was a sort of yellow spots that you see, and then the outlines, and that's a combination between a sort of I think it's a Chinese woodcut from the 13th century. My fascination with Caspar David Friedrich, in terms of what would you get if you would reduce it to snow blinded of one color, which in this case was yellow, and Hitler taking a walk with his friends in Berchtesgaden. So all juxtaposed one over the other. The other one, and this is called Presence here, is actually the one which you saw with the pattern of the, what's it called, the wallpaper. It is called La Correspondance, or correspondence. And it is basically about homesickness. It was about the writer, Van Oudshoorn, who was stationed from 1905 to 1910 in Berlin, and he didn't have money to bring his wife over. In those days, he had elaborate cafes, bourgeois cafes, with a lot of imagery, I mean, a lot of ornaments and all that. And that is symbolized with the wallpaper. The rest is just clinically rendered. What did the guy do? He bought a postcard every afternoon, and he had a red pencil, and he crossed on the table at which he had eaten and sent that to his wife during a period of 5 years, which I think is this ultimate idea of homesickness and presence, in a sense. Yeah, the anecdote is the one that was the very first painting you saw about the brother of my mother, which I already taught. And then there's the idea of the genre, which comes back different stages. You see also the big still life that I made much more later. I made that, that's the biggest, that was at that point the biggest painting. It was 5 meters or something like that. And it was made actually after my wife and I got stuck during 9/11 in New York. And so we saw the planes going into the buildings from every possible angle. It was reasonably disgusting. And when I came back, I didn't know what to do. I mean, you couldn't do anything with that. So I tried to think about something idyllic. And so this is also for the documenta of Okri and Weser, where it was, of course, expected to either work on the colonialism, as I did with the Belgian pavilion. You saw the image of the king, the leopard skin, and all that. I didn't want to do that. I did that only once in the Belgian pavilion. Why? Because the Belgian pavilion is was something that was, it was built by a colonial architect. And so I decided to go into some kind of specific denial and make a political painting, which is this still life, which Sarat Maraj and also Okrin Weser still hates the painting, basically, didn't really understand the understatement of what was going on. The understatement was actually to pick the lowest denominator in the genre of painting, which is notably, although there's a lot of symbolic meaning, there is also sexual meaning, whatever that can be, in which is the still life. Within the back of my head, an unfinished painting of Cézanne I saw in the Sammlung Winterthur, where he just didn't finish the painting, but he used lead white, so that means that the backdrop turns bluish in the end. And I made it, enlarged it. I just sort of like took out the contrast, it became virtually transparent, so it was no longer to be digested in a sense. So that, and the other ones you saw is a triptych where you could see the outline maybe of a lampshade, and the middle one is a sick tooth, and the other one is the window in Auschwitz where they made a clot from a human hair or something like that. I mean, that's an image of cannibalism in a way. And then you have a logic of its own, which is with something like a painting that paintings that had to, that dealt with imagery that came out of publicity. Fascinated by publicity because it is imagery that's no imagery. It sort of instigates imagery. And the one Sif painting you saw with the forms like that and that, that was what looked a little bit like a constructivist painting, is actually based from a product that we still use, I think, Sif to clean. And I took out the name, the price, and changed the colors. I also actually work with tonality, because tonality for me is an important element in terms that it gives you the possibility, although there's a two-dimensional picture plane, to create depth. Actually, more than the idea of more than the idea of perspective in a sense. What else do we got? Then there is this element of disappointment, and the whole idea of disenchantment, which I thought was interesting, which is sort of portraying an element of loss in the imagery, which is was also an interesting start. A lot have been written about that, but of course, in the end, there is also the power of the image, which I think is important. I mean, what was interesting here is to see, I mean, it's very difficult to get across a visual, in a sense. I mean, you can talk about, and I could, of course, easily, as I said, talk about it slide by slide. But I didn't especially want to do that, because I just wanted you to have the virginity, at least, to look at it. And I will, and also you're going to be sitting in the dark for like more than 1.5 hours, and we're not going to go there. So just to talk about what interests me, the interest that I have towards imagery as a whole is the total distrust I have towards it. I mean, even my own, in a sense. And that is played out in very, very different forms. The backbone of the imagery is basically violent, but it's violent in a sense that it has an element of tenderness. Nothing, when violence is tender, there's nothing more brutal than that, in a sense. There is also the element of detachment, and there is the place where I come from. I mean, I come out of Belgium, which means we didn't have time to be romantic, because we were overrun by so many other nations. We had to be opportunistic also, in order of our own survival. And if you talk about Belgium, a lot of people come up with two names. They come up with Magritte, which is a surrealist, which he is not, or was not. He had a fight with Breton. And then the other thing they come up with is Ensor, which is seen as grotesque, which is not. It's a predecessor of expressionism, basically. What people tend to forget is that there was one painter, which comes out of our region, which is the hardest not to crack, which is actually Jan van Eyck. Jan van Eyck was the person who, I'm going to read the other text later, I'm not going to go into this anymore. Jan van Eyck was a guy that, if you born where I come from, you're traumatized from day one. If you blow up the face of a Van Eyck painting, you know, if you take it to the size of a wall, it will remain there, it will be there. It was the first image builder also that by enhancing the idea of the real in terms of the clot, the flesh, whatever you can think of, by enhancing that, he, although working under the cloak of religion, because of those things, every form of science was under the dogma of religion. But what he nevertheless did is by enhancing that the real, he actually got away from the mimetic imagery of Christianity and opened the window to the world. I mean, one could ask oneself the question, if Velázquez saw the wedding of the Arnolfines with the convex mirror, under which he wrote, Jan van Eyck was here, or he also wrote under the painting, both of the paintings are in the National Gallery in London, unluckily for us. But I mean, so and under the one of his wife, he wrote, "I finished her off then and then." So I mean, it doesn't come more unforgiven than that, basically. And that is the core where our image building comes from. It is realism, basically, from head to start, from head to whatever you want to talk about. That's something you should know, because then there is also, as I said, the tonality of which I already talked. We live under gray skies with a certain specific luminosity, which therefore creates a subtlety which would be different if I would live in LA or Spain. The works would look probably completely different. There are elements from the outside that have an impact on the image building, on the way you work with the pictorial. For the rest, I can say, but that maybe I can say when I read the other text on the image, that the work is also an ongoing story. There is no way back in the painting practice. I could easily, and I did sometimes, but then in forms of murals, because I also made another oeuvre which has disappeared, because I've made at least 80 wall paintings. Sometimes out of pragmatic reasons, because there was no money to transport the paintings, or there was no money for the insurance. Most of these paintings just disappear after the duration of the show. Some of them remain because they were made to remain, but that's only four, I think, or something like that. I'm going to make a publication about this oeuvre, which is totally ephemerical in a sense. There's still a plan with the Kanazawa Museum in Japan. Of course, you know, Japan has been through two successive crises, or maybe three, and the tsunami, so they don't have money. And it's a beautiful museum. It's a museum of the 21st century by a great architect. It's a circular museum. And so instead of giving them a lousy show with like 45 paintings, prints, and whatever, and try to solve the question, I decided to make it all into wall paintings, the entire exhibition space, which will take me 3 weeks. And that it will run for 3 months, and at the last 2 weeks they will slowly start to overpaint. The public can still see it. Overpaint, you know, the wall black, again white, and then when it's totally white, we will then actually promote the book with all the vanished wall paintings there. I think that's quite Japanese. It's quite okay. And so another oeuvre, so to speak, which is alongside these situations. Besides from that, I talked with the students, but I also curated shows. There's one I'm going to create, a family is going to open up in London at the Parasol Unit now in a small month or something like that. And I created 10 different shows. And some of them, we didn't talk about all of them with the students, but some we did. There's some books of on the tables. If you want to look, you can look. I think one of the major ones was a show, Trouble Spot Painting, which was made in 1999 with another artist, because I was also co-founder of the biggest artist cooperative ever in Belgium with 1,500 artists. And we worked on two levels. I was, for 7 years, I was the artistic director. Danny DeVos, a performance artist, was the sort of Politburo for the social affairs, because actually the profession of artist didn't really exist on a legal level, so we got that done with lawyers. But we also worked on artistic projects, which means that these were artist-curated shows. And one of those shows was together with Nasty Stordoir, painter, and it was the investigation into the difference between the two-dimensional situation, like, say, take Richter, Heliotitska. Heliotitska, Richter probably people sort of know. Heliotitska is a Brazilian artist who actually worked in the space. I mean, he created like you could go into the painted surface, basically. Up until people like John Baldessari and whatever you can think of. That was the very one, and then, but unfortunately, I didn't find the catalog of that again. But the ones that are here are a show that I did. I did two projects with China, which was a show about, traditional art from the, let's say, the southern part of the Flanders, because in the 15th century, Belgium didn't exist. Belgium is actually a very young country from 1830. It was paid for by the Rothschilds, and they got a king out of England because nobody wanted to be king of it anyhow. So that in conjunction with old Chinese masters. It was the first time that a type of show like that was done. And it was shown in Brussels, in Palais Beaux-Arts, and then went to the Forbidden City where it was destroyed. The concept was destroyed because of several reasons, mostly the reason that my curator from the Forbidden City of the Palace Museum was not hierarchically high up, apparently, and we got something, we got actually a sort of macho, which was actually called Mao, who was a technician and not really a curator. So we had to change overnight in the hotel room the entire setup of the show. Second project was a show with contemporary art, and I didn't want to have the brutal experience again, so I said, I'm going to work with the bully. So I got to Ai Weiwei. Ai Weiwei came to me about more than 15 years ago, unannounced. There were about 10 Chinese guys at noon in front of my door, and I knew Ai Weiwei because I saw on the Progressive Channel in the Dutch television, I saw what he did with, it was a two-day riposte to the Shanghai Biennial, so I knew his face. He stood up and said, you have to do show in China now. But that was years before we did this project, The State of Things, of which there's also a catalog there. And where we were able, with a great deal of problems, to keep the concept together up until all the way in actually the museum, the Namok, which is their main museum. My proposition to Ai Weiwei was, I said, you can keep your block till you're 80 something and become a clown, or we can delve into the system and see what we can do with it. We worked with Van de Jong, who was actually an apparatchik but quite progressive in a sense, was on its way to become actually the Minister of Culture, which didn't happen. Ai Weiwei warns years in advance to leave, which he didn't do, because the problem with the Chinese is that they totally overestimate themselves. That's where they actually are going to die. And that power, and that Ai Weiwei is also, not unlike many other Chinese people I know, a power mongrel. And this all backfired. I met him, he's released, he has his passport, he can travel, because pragmatic as the Chinese are, they destroyed him in his own continent. It's fine. I mean, the West can lionize it. What the fuck? We don't fucking care. And this was a small mistake, I think, of Ai Weiwei in the apprehension of what you actually could do. So that's an interesting thing. But those are all sort of collateral damage next to the work that I actually make. So what I'm going to do now is just going to and this is going to be easy because it's going to be shorter also. I'm going to read you the text on the image. It's a text from 1996. And it's about this difference between the static image, the moving image. So, what distinguishes the static image from the moving one is its permanence, its presence, its perpetuation of a portrayed reality. It is no coincidence that cave paintings were done in inaccessible, often almost concealed places, and that the natural environment was also incorporated into the image. Entry to these places was reserved for only a few who had been initiated into the ritual meaning of these images. He who had an overview had power. Although, in my opinion, the question of the difference between the static and the moving image is essentially irrelevant. After all, both are related. Both are related to reality only as images. I believe their impact is fundamentally different. The static image is not so much framed by space as positioning itself within it. The positioning of the static image in itself also generates more meaning, although both invite the spectator to approach them. The materiality of the static image, whether two or three-dimensional, is always greater. The static image is also less narrative in nature. A route narrative can only be marked out with what lies within the static image. Two views of the static image here come into conflict. On the one hand, the pretentious myth of the image as a synopsis of reality. On the other, the world of ornament compressed to the extreme. Only a fervent plea as the second is concerned, we have to point out the visible working of time, crackler, yellowing, crumbling, and so on. As a consequence of the aging process which takes place in parallel with real life, this loss is in fact inherent in the painting from the start. Every static image depicts its own vanishing from the very time of its creation. It is always finite and precisely for that reason not reproducible. So the image can do nothing other than absorb, soak up, and fade. Unlike when one has a series of images, the destruction of the static image is more complete and absolute. However paradoxical it may sound, the static image can in this way be infinitely more powerful in the memory than the moving image. And I say this because if you would do the test and you would ask somebody to remember a photograph or a painting, we'll see where we get. The inadequacy of remembering a painting totally is impossible. It is a physical procedure which is so detailed that you cannot remember the right color, the right temperature, all the details. It's not a possibility. I mean, it's my conviction, but I mean, we could try the test to really try to describe it. However, yeah, in this way, we use more parallel. Yeah, since it is impossible to regain the original image exactly, a great many meanings can be accumulated, but also misunderstandings. Although the image is fixed, the mental equivalent is constantly and increasingly in movement. The pictorial or sculptural articulation of depth, for example, or light or space, is so impressive because they are both static and finite. The only moving images that also have this power are transmitted images such as those on television. These signal images are not projected, just as in the painting the light comes from within a certain device. The fact that they only become visible by grace of the light that falls on them means colors and tones are much deeper and more consistent. They are therefore more difficult to remember exactly, but easier as a specific degree of hot or cold. I already told that. The static image, much more than a series of images, can still make a mood crystallize into an idea, a pattern, or a master. To conclude, since the static image as a catalyst recurringly records its surroundings, it can say that simultaneously to its decline, it accumulates a huge mass of information. The static image is more fictitious than the moving image, a certain form of impenetrability or even invisibility is reached not by association but rather by combination and distortion. Now we go to the moving image. Film is a product of industrial revolution. Bertrand Russell once said that this revolution provided the tools to design more and more tools, and so on, ad infinitum. Thomas Edison modeled his kinetoscope on the phonograph is a not unimportant and also almost paradoxical fact that the recording and reproduction of audio, the word sound, preceded and even generated the recording and production of the moving image. 1870 saw the birth of a new science, experimental psychology. One of the problems underlying this new discipline was the phenomenon of the image that remained burned on the retina long after the physical cause had passed. This was in fact the first intuitive understanding of the after image. Empirical research involving mirrors and stroboscopes instruments led science to the conclusion that perception takes place in the brain. Almost immediately after that, they deduced that it must be possible to create the illusion of movement by means of a particular malfunction of the human brain or by slightly distorting and the individual recording of an instant. The photo, a third means of depiction, now also appeared, the projection of a series of images. The physicist J.F.A. Plateau, it's a Belgian guy, who lived from 1801 till 1883, experimented with and on himself, and at the age of 28 went blind as a result of looking at the sun too long. He continued to carry out research into the afterimage until he was 82. And along the way, designed the pinakistoscope, sorry about that, a device that analyzes movement. He was the first person to work using photographs devised a way of projecting them on a screen. Ironically, though, and ironically enough, in fact, Edison was already deaf when he designed the phonograph, and Plateau blind when he invented the first rudimentary form of cinema. The explosive growth of the middle class in the late 19th century was accompanied by a rise in the demand for portraits. Artists were unable to keep up with this huge demand. The market was taken over by amateurs equipped with a camera lucida. But this new technique was thought to reduce the subject to a rather lifeless or less animated appearance. This was in contrast with the so-called true art, which was assumed to see the subject as a motive able to evoke memories, emotions, and desires. It was not the photo, but art that invited the viewer to show an empathy that enabled it to come to life. Nowadays, this view seems at the very least odd. Since progress was increasingly put under the label of technical innovation, this idea gradually faded away. Art was increasingly identified with mechanical reproduction. The camera appeared to confirm the behaviorist view of man as a mechanical option. Film helped undermine even more the idea of the one-off, magical, and fetishistic nature attributed to the work of art. The image was for the first time observed as a mass and consumed as reproduction. With the speed of light, the only matter that truly possesses a memory, cinema was able to spread trends and fashion, comfort the masses, and entertain and inform the illiterate. Film cleared the way for new forms of nostalgia, modern sentiments, and a sophisticated form of fetishism. Because they were so short, some of the pioneer films were more like dreams. Is it a coincidence that Freud was working on psychoanalysis at the same time as Lumiere was inventing film? The crucial concept in psychoanalysis is that of the transfer by which the patient projects their or her fantasy into or onto an impersonal screen. If on the one hand we bear the phenomenon of the after image in mind, and on the other way film gives shape to illusion of movement and space, or as it were forces the viewer into a mental leap by means of a close-up, we have to conclude that film has an extremely refined feel for the laws of the psyche. The best film scripts are in fact composed using associative ideas. The film enables space, time, and causality to become effortlessly absorbed into utterly internalized world of memory. The imagination and emotion in film, depth and movement do not appear to us as hard physical facts, but as a mixture of facts and symbols. Now we come to the symbiosis. The two hypotheses formulated above concern two separate developments. When the television forced its way into the living room, and I'm a product of a television generation, which means there has been a great deal of information and imagery and a manco of experience, basically, which is a different way how a generation is informed. When it made its way into the living room, the two were suddenly able to be linked. The static image and the projection of a series of images, once again, experience of the image and of its materiality was narrowed. Instead of being projected, the television picture is transmitted. It is now no more than a signal. And every signal is like any other, since the fact of its transmission erases any notion of editing. What else is this standardized image area by necessity reduced in size but a rotating disk? Whereas we have never been so literally detached from the image, the impact on the viewer, which cannot be defined as anything but physical, has been maximized. The instant of experience has been banished and alienated from any real-time span. And the instant has become code that is perfectly able to skim across the surface of the existing reality. The information reduced to its most rudimentary form, which means impulse and reaction, is virtually total. What follows is addiction. The image as such has become invisible, unknowable, and anonymous, its meaning indiscoverable as a result of being fragmented into thousands of possible interpretations. The earth has shrunk in time and space into a global village, while in psychological terms the world has surged outwards countless times. work is done on the potential of the user at the same time as on the boundless and immediate, and equally experience free accessibility. The image itself becomes a producer, it's no longer dependent on the consumer only in terms of his turning it on or off. The user can now also make changes to the visual information. One image can be isolated from a series and stored. The image is once again reduced, this time by digitalization, whereas it is defined within the binary system. The web brings together every sort of information, regardless of differences in meaning, in a single non-place. The possibilities seem unlimited, but so is the confusion. Some people, mainly in the United States, see the internet as the ultimate realization of the old dream of equality by means of new technological achievement. But there are problems too. It is, as has been suggested, indeed no longer necessary to activate political awareness, since all the information should be available anyway. The question is for and by and whom is the information centralized? Who keeps track of it? There is an urgent need for research into the tactical use of media, where attention will be focused undiminished on the difference between the intimate media and the mass media. We do not stand apart from the image, but are in its midst. We shall ourselves have to determine and learn to determine when we appear and disappear. In this sense, the old aristocratic dream of immersing oneself in a morass of sensuality has mutated into the concept of the self dominated entirely by technical devices, each individual as his own pornographer. Now, the epilogue. Now, these three developments and their mutual influence have been outlined, we should look explicitly at art. So what is art? Is art a translator of the above-mentioned aristocratic idea of complete surrender to perfect pleasure and true luxury? Or is art by necessity always that same anachronistic mixture of opposites? I don't know. As an artist operating in the ever-decelerating reality of the art world, I can only observe that behind the mask of what is presented as image lies a substantial loss of meaning. The question of whether photography, film, television, or even the internet is art by no means offsets the question of the quality of a particular communication or meaning. Let's be honest, the institution that is art, or that into which it has then degenerated, remains conservative. It cherishes in the most improbable manner a past that appeals to the imagination and allows us to dream of our own history, and this institution has always been dependent on the balance of power. It has never been an actual reality, but also always a pure fiction, a sort of superstition. To then claim that film, a technical innovation which simulated by American industry, has expanded into the most important form of entertainment is art, is of course problematic, because it's irrelevant, let alone that this relatively recent medium might or should lead to anything as insane as a Gesamtkunstwerk, which I think is the most dangerous thing on the globe. Film naturally has a visual contribution to make, and of course cinema has a chance of survival, because just like all other media, it can generate meaning. The danger is just that in today's art circle, it's precisely these various levels that are no longer differentiated, and art people settle for a literal, far too literal interpretation. And it is here, and this is what I fear, that we miss the opportunity, that the missed opportunity is to be found. It is plainly clear that film, television, and the new media have an obvious influence on current image information. However, a precise definition of the impact remains unforthcoming while dwelling on the surface of use and presentation. The irrevocable result is a want of meaning and utter predictability. So just to give an idea of how I sort of think about the image, I mean, as a modem. And the interesting thing with these 3 days was that in order to get to that, it took a while to start to talk about it, because people come from philosophy. I mean, when you ask them what their images are, I mean, that sort of stuff. So it was an interesting voyage.